Hey everyone, welcome to another edition of Power Core Productions and Podcastings. I'm your host, Jerron Harrington, back to hit you with another video. And today, we are going to be continuing What If Deku Was Iron Man? My Hero Acedamia Armored Adventures, Part 4. As always, if you're a fan of today's video and everything else that we have on the channel, then please, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share, and hit that bell for post notifications so you can stay up to date on everything that is Power Core Productions and Podcastings that has to come out now and in the future. Where we last left off with our series, we were in the middle of the sports festival. With the cavalry battle now complete and with the brackets now set, we enter into the final rounds of the sports festival, a 16-man single elimination tournament, with Izuku's first round matchup being against the mysterious student known as Shinzo. How will Izuku fare with the power of his suit on his side as he goes up against some of UA's very best in the first years? Also, who will be watching the sports festival from the shadows? And what will happen when the Mandarin and his dark forces make their moves? For all this and more, stay tuned as we now continue What If Deku Was Iron Man? My Hero Acedamia Armored Adventures, Part 4. But anyway, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. As the finals were about to begin, Izuku would look through his armor, making sure that everything was as stable and as ready as it could be. Outside of making a few adjustments in between rounds, assuming he made it that far, this was all he was going to have going into his battles, so he had to make the most of it. As the students were preparing to file out, Izuku's match being first, Momo would walk up to him and wish him good luck, giving him a peck on the cheek, well, technically his helmet, since his helmet was on before he went out. As he was making his way to the entrance tunnel, he would be stopped by Dinky Kaminari, who had warned him about Shinzo and his quirk, noting that that was probably the reason why he dropped out in the first place. Izuku was thankful for the advice, although he kind of wished that Dinky hadn't exposed it to him. He didn't want that type of unfair advantage, although all the same, not like it really mattered in the grand scheme of things. If that was all that his quirk could do, then Izuku wasn't really all that impressed. As they made their way out into the battle arena, Izuku standing across from Shinzo. Shinzo would attempt to use his quirk, trying to get Izuku to answer his question, but Izuku would say nothing. He stood motionless. If no one knew correctly, they would assume that Shinzo was talking to a robot. When Shinzo finally realized that his words were not going to get to him at all, he started throwing insults, as many as he could. However, Izuku was a lot more tough than Shinzo gave him credit. Having to go through life without a quirk, to try to stand on his own two feet, it made people like Izuku a lot more resilient, so that simple words weren't going to affect him. As Izuku walked closer to Shinzo, Shinzo started to step back, Izuku saying absolutely nothing. The expressionless motion of face of his helmet, giving off a cold and lifeless demeanor. For Shinzo, he didn't feel like he was in the ring with an opponent. He felt as though he were in the ring with a monster. Shinzo slowly started to back away, realizing that he didn't have anything else in his arsenal, nothing to his name. Before long, Izuku would have Shinzo pinned against the edge of the arena about to fall over. Shinzo was left speechless with no words. There was nothing that he could do. With a simple thrust, Izuku would push Shinzo out of the ring. A bit anticlimactic, to say the least. As Izuku got ready to leave, Shinzo would yell in anger. He yelled that it wasn't fair, that if he had been born with a better quirk, then maybe he could have done more. What was he supposed to do in the situation he was in now? However, that caught Izuku's attention. He turned around to Shinzo and grabbed him by the collar and lifted him up. He would tell him that he was born quirkless. He didn't have anything. As far as everyone else was concerned, he wasn't even supposed to be here right now. And yet here he was. No quirk, nothing but his own brains and intellect, and he was able to win. In the end of the day, if Shinzo didn't like his lot in life, then he needed to improve and stop blaming others for his faults. His quirk was actually quite amazing, and Izuku even started to list off various ways that he could have used it to his advantage. He thought taking Dinky Kaminari out of the tournament was going to gain him some favor. If he were smart, he would have took out Izuku, or Todoroki, or even Bakugo or Shang-Chi. He could have caught one of them off guard at least, but he went after the weakest, which showed the true mind state that he had. In the end, he tried to take the shortcut, and he got dealt the short hand. As Izuku let Shinzo go, he told him if he wanted help, he'd gladly give it to him. There were plenty of things they could do with that quirk of his, but he had to actually want it. He had to actually want to try, because if he didn't, then he would always stay the way that he was. And with that, Izuku would win and advance to the second round, as Shinzo was left there to wonder and think. The next match would be Tokoyami versus Ibarra. The match was also rather uneventful, although it was exciting in the beginning. Tokoyami used Dark Shadow to try to attack, though Ibarra would use her plant-like hair to create walls of defense. The rather zealous girl didn't really like violence and wasn't really prone to fighting. So with that, Dark Shadow would scoop her up gracefully and just bow her out of the ring, as he didn't think that someone of her caliber would want to fight unnecessarily, and since he actually wanted to move on, he gave her a proper ring out. And with that, Tokoyami would advance to the next round. The third match would be Kendo versus Momo Yayorozu. As Momo stepped into the arena, she was a bit nervous. As such, she was caught off guard when Kendo jumped her, using her large hands to try to punch away at her. Momo would duck and dodge to the best of her abilities. Using her creation quirk, she would create a shield to try to block. However, Izuku would yell out to her from the stands, telling her to snap out of it and to use her head. In doing so, Momo would calm herself and think, nearly avoiding a ring out at the last moment, as she made her way back to the center of the arena with Kendo. Momo had to stop and think about what she wanted to create. However, she had a good source of inspiration. All her years spent with Izuku, watching him invent various things, it gave her the inspiration to study even more. She was even able to remember some of the schematics for Izuku's various inventions. The first thing she made were stun grenades, throwing them down in front of Kendo and obscuring her vision just long enough as Momo would create another shield. However, this time it was a bit different, as the shield in and of itself was made out of rubber. When Kendo attempted to go in for a punch, the rubber was able to absorb a lot of the damage as she went closer, before Momo would create another creation, that being of a punching glove attached to the end of a gun, knocking Kendo in the face and knocking her across the arena. Momo would then use her creations once again, next creating a large cannon. Thankfully, the cannonballs were non-lethal, although they were still dangerous nonetheless. Kendo, using her large hands, would attempt to knock and swat them away. Momo, however, continued on with the assault, as she used her various forms of creation in order to match Kendo and catch her off guard, before finally knocking her out of the arena. Momo would help Kendo up, as Kendo was actually impressed by Momo and her abilities. But it wasn't just Kendo. There was someone else in the stands watching Momo also, and he had a smile on his face, happy that he had taken the advice of a certain student to watch and see what she could do. The fourth match would be Ashido versus Todoroki. Like the matches beforehand, it didn't go very long, and it didn't need to, mainly because Todoroki believed in winning rather effectively. Ashio attempted to use her acid, but it was quickly frozen over. When it became apparent she had no chance in winning, Ashio quickly gave up, and with that, Todoroki advanced to the second round. The fifth match was Kirishima versus Tetsu Tetsu. The two had very similar quirks, to say the least. Kirishima's hardening quirk and Tetsu Tetsu's iron body quirk. The two of them were a lot alike, kindred souls in a way, as they would match one another. However, ultimately, Kirishima would get the better of the two in the exchange, and he would advance. The sixth match was Bakugo versus Ochako Uraraka. Uraraka would perform a lot better against Bakugo here than she did in the original timeline, mainly because of the influence of Shang-Chi. The two had become very close. Not that Ochako wasn't friendly with Izuku, but you could say that in this time of events, Shang sort of takes Izuku's place in this regard, and she learns a lot from him. He gave her a few tips when it came to hand-to-hand combat, thus giving her an added tool in her arsenal against Bakugo. While her plan was a lot similar to before, ultimately though, Bakugo would get the win. However, even he would have to admit that Ochako was pretty dangerous, as Bakugo advanced to the next round. The seventh match was Ida versus Mei Hatsume. This wasn't so much a match, more so than it was a way for Mei to show off her various inventions to the crowd, showing what she was capable of, and using Ida as a guinea pig. However, once her presentation was over, she gladly bowed out of the ring, giving Ida the win and letting him advance to the second round. Finally, in the eighth match, Shang-Chi versus Zero. Zero attempted to use his tape to bind Shang-Chi and throw him around. However, Shang was easily able to avoid many of Zero's attacks. For Shang, outside of the flame Makuan ring that he wore on his fingers, he was mainly known for using his chi to enhance his strength and speed in martial arts. As such, with a flurry of barrages and kicks, he was pretty much able to render Shiro basically defeated, and as such, he would advance to the next round. There would be a brief intermission, as everyone would be given a chance to rest up, around 10 minutes before the second round began. Izuku, tooling his armor and making sure everything was set, would prepare himself, as his next match was against Tokoyami. Momo would come up to Izuku, a bit nervous, as she had a matchup against Todoroki. However, Izuku would assure her that everything was going to be fine. He believed in her, and he knew that she could win. Besides, he knew that she had been studying his schematics for years, so why not use a thing or two from him and give it her all? And with that, Momo would feel a lot more determined, ready to defeat Todoroki. Kirishima was gearing himself up for Bakugo, while Shang-Chi meditated for his match against Tenya Iida. Before long, the second round would begin, as Izuku stood across from Tokoyami. Tokoyami would unleash Dark Shadow that would come flying towards Izuku at once. Izuku holding up both of his arms, the strength of his armor proving to be formidable as he held against the shadow-like beast. As the two sized each other up in the middle of the arena, Izuku would use his repulsor rays against Dark Shadow, although the quick-moving Shadow would be able to evade to a certain extent as he continued on attacking Izuku. From out of nowhere, he would wrap himself around Izuku's body, holding his arms and legs in place as they tried to push him out of the arena. However, Izuku would use the Uni Beam on his chest to blast away a Dark Shadow, the powerful light beam doing great damage against the shadowy beast. It didn't take Izuku long to deduce that it took light in order to defeat Dark Shadow, since they were already fighting during the bright light of day, with the sun shining high above them. Dark Shadow wasn't as strong as it could be, and if the repulsor rays were anything like light itself, then Dark Shadow would be weakened the more he hit it. As such, instead of fighting from a distance, Izuku chose to get in close range. He would close off his uni beams and hold up his fist, forcing Tokoyami to think that Izuku was going in for hand-to-hand combat, at which point he believed the Dark Shadow had the power to match him. As the Dark Shadow-like beast would lunge towards Izuku once again, the two of them exchanging hands with one another, engaging in a good old fisticuffs, Izuku from out of nowhere would grip Dark Shadow's arms with both of his own, holding him up close as he used his uni beam to blast him at point-blank range. Although he tempered down the potency of the attack, as he didn't want to do any too much lasting damage, although it was enough to weaken him to a degree, as Izuku beat down Dark Shadow, forcing him into submission. As Tokoyami was now left on the ground with no way to defend himself, Izuku would hold up his uni beam before telling him to forfeit, since the match was over. With no other choice, Tokoyami would agree and would bow out of the match. However, Izuku would make sure to show him the proper respect, since he knew that if they were fighting under different circumstances, this wouldn't have been so easy, encouraging Tokoyami to continue forward, as he believed that with more training, he and Dark Shadow could become even stronger and be even more formidable opponents. The next match was Momo versus Todoroki. As the two made their way to the arena, Todoroki would warn that she didn't have anything that could take him down, and that she would be wise to simply give up. However, Momo had no intentions on doing so, as she lunged towards Todoroki. Todoroki would stand still, creating a large blockade of ice to try to push her out of the way. However, Momo would smirk as she went flying high into the air. Izuku wondered what she was doing until he realized she had made a pair of his rocket boots. He couldn't believe that she had been able to make something that convoluted so quickly, and the fact that she was able to copy them to such a degree. However, he could see the strain on her body. To make something that complicated with her creation quirk, it meant she had to have studied some of his older notes, and he could tell since the rocket boots were from the older models of his armor, the Mark 1s. He remembered that armor being durable, but it was also bulky and a bit cumbersome. As such, she quickly disposed the boots once she got past the blockade of ice, as she made her way towards Todoroki. He attempted to swipe at her with another ice attack. However, she would throw out a couple of grenades, blowing the ice away immediately, before appearing next to him and creating a sword. The sword would slice through some of his ice constructs, forcing him on the retreat. When out of nowhere, she would deliver a punch to his gut, before a blast would send him rocketing across the arena once again. She had made the gauntlet as well. Momo continued to lunge forward with her attack. She was already burning through a lot of calories, a lot of the lipids in her body that she used for her creation quirk. While Momo was creative, she did have a certain limit to a degree. Todoroki continued his attack as he used his ice to try to flood the entire arena. However, Momo would lunge herself into the air once again. On her right arm, she would create a bazooka. Aiming it perfectly, she launched the payload towards Todoroki, who would create a large wall of ice to block the attack. In the midst of the explosion, smoke would cover the arena, an icy fog that no one could see through. Before another large explosion would be heard, they began to go off repeatedly over and over again. Momo was launching now a payload of mini grenades, trying her best to bomb Todoroki into submission, before eventually she landed back in the arena once again. However, she could tell that this time she was at the end of her rope, and she didn't have much left to fight with. Before long, though, she would fall to one of her knees. She tried to stand once again. However, Todoroki would now stand in front of her, as he held up his hand to her face. He warned her that while she had fought well, it was time to give up. Momo looked at him. She didn't want to end here, but she knew better than to push past her limits. With that, she would hold her head down as she would give up. And with that, Todoroki would be declared the winner. Momo felt as though she were about to pass out. She wished that she just had a little more strength. Maybe if she could have kept going, she could have won. As she was about to fall over, though, she fell into someone's arms. It was Izuku, who had come by to get her in the nick of time. As Izuku looked up at Todoroki, and Todoroki looked back at him, the two of them knowing they were going to meet in the semi-finals. Izuku knew that this match was going to be a bit personal. All the same, he carried Momo out of the arena. He told her that she did a really good job, and he was proud of her. While he couldn't see it, with her hair covering her eyes, one single tear would fall down her cheek, as that was something she was happy to hear, as Izuku took Momo to Recovery Girl. In the meanwhile, the next two second round matches would take place. Bakugo would defeat Kirishima to advance to the semifinals. And the final match of the second round would be Tenya Iida versus Shang-Chi. For Shang, he had a bit of a hard time keeping up with Iida in his speed. Even he had to admit in that department, Iida had him beat. But there was one thing that gave Shang the advantage. Even if his body couldn't physically match Tenya's speed, there was one thing he had. His reflexes were second to none. He was able to dodge every kick that Iida was able to throw at him, even when Iida attempted to use his reciprocal burst, launching a flurry of kicks. Shang dodged and blocked almost every single one. Except there was one kick that got past his defenses, hitting him in the side. He felt as though a few of his ribs might have been broken by that reciprocal burst kick as he went flying across the arena, almost being knocked out. With Iida knowing that he didn't have much time left, he would go in for the final strike. However, at the last moment, Shang would do a reverse bicycle kick, kicking him square in the chin and knocking him straight into the air, sending him flying out of the arena. As Shang stood up, he would be declared the winner and would advance to the semifinals to face Bakugo. He went into the locker room and got as much injury tape as he could, taping up his ribs, as he knew that if he had gone to Recovery Girl, they were only going to do but so much. And besides, he wanted to see just how far he could go. Before long, the semi-final rounds were going to begin. Todoroki had already made his way to the arena, and Izuku was on his way as well, when he was stopped by Endeavor in the halls. The number two hero would speak to Izuku, knowing that he was impressed that a boy without a quirk could manage to get this far. He would tell for Izuku to take his son out if he was only going to use the ice side of his quirk, and if he wasn't going to give it his all, then he needed to be humiliated, and nothing would be more humiliating than losing to a quirkless opponent. However, Izuku ignored the number two hero, telling him that he was pathetic if he thought that he was going to be used for his little game. He wanted to see what Todoroki could do also with his full power, but that was because he wanted Todoroki to be better than his father. Endeavor looked at him menacingly. However, Izuku shot back a glare of his own, one that showed that he wasn't intimidated by Endeavor at all, and Endeavor would back down. With that, Izuku would make his way out to the arena, with his helmet now closed and ready to go. He and Todoroki would stand ready for battle. As Todoroki would create a large wall of ice, Izuku would blast it away with his repulsor rays as he went rocketing towards Todoroki. Todoroki would allow him to get close. Before their hands could even touch, he would create a sharp high increase of ice, doing so freezing Izuku's left arm. As he had done it, Izuku found it hard to use his left arm at all. His suit had been made for a lot of things, but countering frost was one thing he hadn't factored into it. It took him a while to break free, and even then, to get control over his left arm it took some time, as Todoroki continued the onslaught of ice barrage. Izuku would use his good right arm and punch away at the ice, being able to do so to a certain degree, although the ice was pretty dense, and punching through it repeatedly was wearing his armor down just a bit. As he continued to fight away, he did see that he was taking more and more damage, and it was taking more and more power out of him to be able to counter. Although eventually, he was able to see that Todoroki was running low on steam himself. Just using his ice side, he was suffering from frostbite as well. His body was over-freezing, and if he wasn't going to use his flame quirk, then that would lead to him getting the win ultimately. Izuku would then counter as he went flying into the air, too high for Todoroki to aim his ice at, before rocketing down at him, spinning and using his repulsor rays, blasting them down in a spiraling downpour of blast that started to rain down on the arena, knocking down and destroying his ice constructs, before Izuku got close enough to Todoroki, who attempted to use more and more of his ice. However, it started to become less and less effective. Izuku's plan was panning out. The more ice that Todoroki used, the less effective it became. Without the balance of using his flame to keep everything even keel, in the end, Todoroki, hypothetically, would either freeze out or flame out. And in this case, he was freezing out. His ice becoming less and less effective until he could create little more of it. Izuku finally broke through his icy defense before knocking him down and grabbing him by the collar, telling him that he was pathetic right now, and that this wasn't what he came for. Todoroki looked at him angrily. However, before he could say anything, Izuku would continue to speak, telling him that the quirk was his, not his father's or anyone else's. If he was going to hold back for that stupid reason, then Izuku was going to leave right now. He threw Todoroki to the ground and made his way towards the arena to walk away. Todoroki looking at him angered. He asked why was he going to leave, to give up everything. Izuku remarked that if Todoroki wasn't going to give it his all, then why should he? There was no reason to go overboard for something that wasn't worth it. Hearing those words, Todoroki then realized what he meant. Izuku was remarking that if he wanted to, he could have ended the fight at any time if he chose. He was holding back on purpose. If someone who was quirkless was saying such a claim to him, it insulted his pride, everything that he thought he stood for. Todoroki would then be flooded with various images from his past, remembering the time he spent with his mother before everything changed. He remembered the hero that he wanted to be, and he didn't want to give up. He didn't want things to end like this. Izuku, while he did have some power left in his suit, and it was thanks to the power of the power ring at his disposal that was able to keep him going. However, even he had to admit, Todoroki just using his ice alone had damaged his suit to a considerable amount, as his suit wasn't completely made to counter frost just yet. He knew that it was going to be a lot of work, as he heard flames emanating from behind him. He turned to see Todoroki with a smile, as he thanked Izuku, as he was going to give it his all and use his full power. Izuku turned back to him, as he gauged just how much power he had left in his suit. He was shocked to see that he only had around 40%. He couldn't imagine that that was even possible. The idea that he didn't have that much power left? That Todoroki had really taken him that far with just his ice? Well, it's no wonder why people had such high praise for him, if he was this dangerous. But still, Izuku stood determined, as he clenched both his fists together, as he yelled out with joy, telling Todoroki that now it was time for them to take this serious. The two of them would begin their battle once again, Todoroki throwing out flames along with the ice, his body starting to regulate its temperature, his ice now going back up to its maximum strength, and now his flames rising to meet that. Izuku's suit had to deal with the constant flux in temperature, from overheating to overcooling, his suit trying to regulate the temperature within it just to hold his own, as he was now fighting a battle on two fronts. Before long, as they stood across from one another, they knew that they were going to have to give it all to their next attack, as Todoroki created a wall of ice and a wall of fire. Izuku focused all of his energy towards the uni beam in his chest. Two large lights emanated from both sides of the arena. For one, it was the side of a boy who was quirkless, of a boy who got as far as he did on his own strength and intelligence. And on the other was a boy destined for greatness, a boy who was the son of a prodigy hero in his own right. The two of them were polar opposites to one another, but yet, they both signified that they would carry on the future of heroes, of what heroes could strive to be even while quirkless, and what heroes with quirks should aim for themselves. Cementos and the other teachers, sensing just how much destruction might come about, would create multiple blocks of cement, creating a great barrier between the two to try to shield from the main attack. The two would let out their final blast as they both collided with one another, the arena being lit up with lights never before seen, as a great explosion would occur in the middle of the arena. With smoke covering everything, it would take a while for it to dissipate and for everyone to see what had happened. The final outcome being that both Todoroki and Izuku were both out of the ring. Izuku was blasted into the side walls of the arena, pretty deep. If it wasn't for the armor that he was wearing, he would have died. As for Todoroki, he attempted to create a cushion of ice, but still he was knocked firmly out of the arena as well. It was a double knockout, and the two of them would both be counted out. With that, the next match in the semifinals effectively became the finals. With both Izuku and Todoroki being knocked out, they were both placed in third, meaning that the final match between Shang-Chi and Bakugo would determine who would come in first and second. Even though Shang had gone to Recovery Girl at the request of Uraraka, his body had not healed entirely. In fact, the right side of his body, especially his ribs, were still damaged considerably. Recovery Girl wanted Shang to drop out, since if he attempted to fight hard, especially against Bakugo, he was only going to injure himself even further. But Shang had no intentions on dropping out, at least not now. As for Bakugo, he was a bit ticked off. He wanted to face against either Izuku or Todoroki also, but the two of them had taken each other out, so there was nothing that he could do about that. As he turned his attentions towards Shang-Chi, the two of them now entering into what was left of the arena, they would begin the final round. Shang would attempt to hold his own as Bakugo would hit him with a barrage of explosions. Shang would counter with his martial arts, channeling his chi into his arms and to his legs in order to withstand the attacks of the explosions while countering with some of his own. He knew he would have to rely on the power of the flame ring. As he did so, fire would emanate from the fist that the ring was on as he blasted some of his fire towards Bakugo, though Bakugo would counter with his explosions, the two of them going at one another rather intently. For Bakugo, he wasn't as versed in the martial arts as Shang was, though Bakugo had a different style of fighting. It wasn't that he was inept in any way, but it was that when it came to battling, he was more of a street brawler than anything else. And street brawling was just as much technique as anything else. He would hit him with precise knee strikes to the gut, causing Shang to cough up some blood as he looked up towards Bakugo, but he was quick to give him a receipt with an upper kick himself, knocking him into the air. Bakugo catching himself with explosions as he went raining down towards him. He would use the howitzer impact, raining down a barrage of explosions towards Shang-Chi, who would try to block and parry as many of the explosion attacks as he could, as he launched out a flame attack of his own, the flaming spiral of the dragon. As a large fire-like dragon itself would emanate from his fist, launching straight towards Bakugo. Bakugo would cuss both his hands together before launching his own powerful explosion, that being the TNT fist. In doing so, the two would collide with one another as the sparks of flame and explosion would bellow all throughout the arena. Everyone watching on as the strong surge of fire between the two of them continued to grow stronger and stronger. Before long, the two of them were throwing out fiery attacks, kicks, punches, and everything in between. The people were far more impressed than anything they could have imagined. To see what these young kids were capable of was more of an understatement than anything else. They were definitely more than capable of being on their own as heroes. All that mattered was them getting the proper training, and before long, there wasn't anything they wouldn't be able to do. Ultimately, though, the battle was reaching its climax, as both Bakugo and Shang-Chi knew that the next attack would be the decisive one. Bakugo knew that Shang's right side had taken the most damage, and he was going to aim his explosion there, while Shang knew that he needed one precise punch to take the victory. And with that, the two of them would go launching towards one another. Shang channeled as much chi as he could into his fist, while Bakugo channeled everything he could into his explosions. As the two of them collided, they would throw out their final attack. Bakugo launched a powerful explosion at Shang's right side, and as for Shang, with his left fist imbued with pure chi, almost like it was glowing, a golden bright. He would punch at Bakugo's kidney. The two of them would cough up blood instantly before falling back, the two of them breathing in heavily as they looked at one another, both of them having a satisfied smirk on their face. Bakugo remarked that he was going to be the winner, although Shang would remark, maybe next time. As Bakugo continued with the smile, he would fall over and be knocked out. And with that, Shang-Chi would win the sports festival. As the crowd roared with approval, although still concerned for the children's safety, both would be taken to Recovery Girl. Recovery Girl scolding the two of them for doing so much damage that they had done to one another. Izuku was in the room as well, along with Todoroki. Izuku had to step out of his armor so that he could be healed properly, and it was being kept stored away until he could get to it again. With that, he put on his regular tracksuit once again. After some time, the boys would be sent out to receive their medals. Shang would be given gold for first, while Bakugo would be given silver for second, while two bronze would be given to both Izuku and Todoroki. All Might would commend the four boys, noting that they fought with heart and with conviction. They had truly left everything in the ring and they had gone beyond, truly going plus plus ultra. And he couldn't think of better heroes to carry on into the future. As the boys accepted their honors, the crowd cheering in approval for their performances, Momo would congratulate Izuku as well, giving him a hug. Although she would need to be careful as the boy was still wrapped up from his fight, and he was doing in pretty bad shape. But still, he was happy to see her again. Before long, All Might would call Momo over, as there was something he wished to discuss with the girl. Believing that out of everyone he had seen, he had finally found what he was looking for. In the meanwhile, off in Hosu City, deep in a dark alley, the hero Ingenium lies in a pool of his own blood. He has been stabbed in the back with multiple jagged shards of ice, as well as being cut by other blades. As the hero killer walks from the damage he has committed, he smiles sinisterly with a yellow ring on his finger. This was the Makuan Ring of Ice, something that he had gotten into his possession, and it served him well, his tool to carry out justice. Our attention would then switch to the Isles of China. There, a man would be looking over the final stages of his armor. This man is known as the Mandarin. He too was watching the sports festival, and he had finally found what he had been looking for. His son, Shang-Chi, whom he believed had gone into exile with his former wife, had now rearisen, and what was more so, he had one of the Makuan rings. As the Mandarin looked down at his hand, he had one ring of his own, the Black Ring of Darkness. That still left him 9 more to find. But it looked as though Japan was a good place to start. With that, he would send 2 of his 10 shadows to collect not only the Fire Ring, but his son. These 2 were well-known villains in the United States, but had now been brought under and hired by the Mandarin to be 2 of his 10 shadows to serve under him. These two villains were known as the Living Laser and the Gray Gargoyle. The two of them setting off at once after Shang-Chi. This concludes What If Deku Was Iron Man? My Hero Academia Armored Adventures Part 4. If you enjoyed today's video and everything else that we have on the channel, then please don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share, and hit that bell for post notifications so you can stay up to date on everything that is Power Core Productions and Podcasting status to come out now and in the future. Stay tuned for tomorrow's video as we are going to be starting a brand new series on the channel. That is, What If Belle Crennel Was Thor? Don Machi, The Last King, Season 1, Part 1. But anyway, that's going to do it for the end of today's video. I'm Javon Harrington with Power Core Productions and Podcastings, signing off, and I'll see you next time.